More and more often, we hear that the climate around us is changing. Moreover, our own observations speak in favor of this assertion. Summers are getting hotter, winters are getting warmer, and in spring, instead of migratory birds, you may see a real blizzard outside your window. What is going on with our climate? Are these anomalies the harbingers of global warming, or is there something quite supernatural awaiting us in the future, such as a new ice age? Let's look into all of this in order. 1. Global warming. On August 21, 1981, scientists first reported the upcoming threat of global warming on Earth. The term global warming itself in widespread use introduced Wallace Broecker, an American geologist and climatologist. Looking ahead, a range of agreements and protocols were later signed, regulating the actions of nations and aiming to minimize damage to our planet from human activities. Climate research experts believe that today and in the future, it is changing to a greater extent due to anthropogenic factors, that is, human activities such as industrial emissions of gases. On December 13, 2019, the EU presented its strategy for climate protection until the middle of the 21st century. According to it, within the next 30 years, greenhouse gas emissions in the EU must be reduced to zero. In December 2020, the UN Secretary General launched a campaign against climate change. In his opinion, an irresponsible attitude to the environment is tantamount to suicide because nature always strikes back and does it with superior force and fury. There is a range of facts to illustrate this. Over the last half century, the temperature in Southeast Antarctica has increased by 2.5 degrees Celsius. In 2002, an iceberg measuring 3,250 square kilometers broke off from an ice shelf glacier located on the Antarctic Peninsula. Then, in 2017, a new iceberg, this time nearly twice as large and weighing about 1 trillion tons, broke off from the glacier again. Since the 1950s, the area of the glacier has shrunk by a third. The mass of Antarctic ice is decreasing at an accelerating rate. Nevertheless, its glaciation area is growing. According to experts, the process that protects glaciers from shrinking in the coming decades will stop, accelerating their melting. The process of degradation of permafrost has also accelerated. Since the early 1970s, the temperature of perennially frozen ground in western Siberia has increased by 1 degree Celsius and in northern Alaska by 3 degrees Celsius since the mid-1980s. In September 2005, American explorer Dennis Schmidt discovered that the peninsula, which had been connected to the land of Liverpool in Greenland by ice as early as 2002, had become a real island. 2. Milankovitch hypothesis. Is this the first time such events occur on our planet, though? 100 years ago, Serbian mathematician and geophysicist Milutin Milankovitch formulated the hypothesis that due to regular changes in orbital parameters such as eccentricity, the tilt of the axis of rotation and precession, the Earth's surface is heated differently by the Sun. As a result, glaciations occur, followed by warmer periods called interglacials. These are the so-called Milankovitch cycles, and today they are the basis for long-term climate forecasts. Each orbital parameter has its own cyclicity. All these factors together give a frequency of climatic changes of 41 and 100,000 years. At the same time, according to calculations, the difference in the amount of sunlight in the northern hemisphere reaches as much as 20%. During the Pleistocene epoch, from 2.6 million to 11.7 thousand years ago, the Earth experienced several cold periods when glaciers occupied up to 30% of the planet and reached the fourth parallel in the northern hemisphere. The last glacial maximum was about 18,000 years ago, and now, according to Milankovitch cycles, the Holocene interglacial, which began about 12,000 years ago, continues. That is what opponents of the hypothesis of anthropogenic influence on the climate refer to when it comes to global warming. However, a more accurate simulation shows that what is happening now is no way fits into natural cycles, neither in strength nor in dynamics. According to Milankovitch cycles, the planet should be gradually cooling today, but the Industrial Revolution at the end of the century before last reversed this natural pattern. The main reason is anthropogenic emissions of greenhouse gases, most of all CO2. Scientists from the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research note that the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere has reached its maximum in 3 million years. However, from 1998 to 2013, climatologists noted a strange phenomenon. The increase of CO2 in the atmosphere continues, while the temperature growth seems to have stopped. This was recorded by IPCC experts in their report, 2014. Scientists couldn't understand what was happening, because the observations contradicted all climate models. Some scientists directly began to reject global warming as a fact. However, in 2013, temperatures went up again, and climatologists started talking about the fact that probably such 15-year pauses occur, with a certain periodicity, about once every 30 years. The paradox of the stabilization of global temperatures against the background of increasing atmospheric CO2 concentrations had to be explained somehow. Otherwise, the forecast simulation based on simple extrapolation looked shaky. Then, Chinese scientists from Lanzhou University suggested a refined climate model, taking into account the redistribution of energy between the atmosphere and the ocean. It turned out that during the period of a seeming pause in warming, Earth continues to heat up, but heat is accumulated in the depths of the world's oceans. After the heat capacity of the ocean reaches a certain level, the temperature of the upper layers of water rises again, hence the cyclicity associated with it. 3. The Little Ice Age. So, what do we know about the temperature drops mentioned in Milankovitch's cyclic model? After all, this winter has been a real test for Europe. In Spain, for example, an alert was announced for most of the kingdom due to snowfall, cold weather, and strong wind gusts. The thermometer in the Catalan Pyrenees dropped to minus 34 degrees Celsius, and in Madrid, heavy snowfall was observed for the first time in 10 years. Several settlements in Italy found themselves under a 2-meter layer of snow, like in Germany, where long traffic jams have formed on some autobahns because of the trucks stuck in the snow. Some media have already christened the consequences of the current storm as snow lockdown. The American continent has been hit hard this winter too. On the night of February 1st, a heavy snowfall with wind hit northeast of the United States. In New York City alone, 40 centimeters of snow fell in a day, and city authorities were forced to declare a state of emergency. Bad weather also affected the Midwest and the southern part of the United States. Texas has suffered the most, and millions of residents were left without power. Maybe these events are the harbingers of some larger cataclysm, and we will soon face another unprecedented cold snap. Indeed, the milestones of human history have preserved such information, and the period of global cooling that took place on Earth during the 14th to 19th century was called the Little Ice Age. It was the coldest time at the average annual temperatures over the past 2,000 years. Nevertheless, this glacial period was preceded by a small climatic optimum with relatively warm weather, mild winters, and the absence of severe droughts. Everything changed when 4 gloomy and rainy summers followed the traditionally warm 1311. In England, since the autumn of 1313, and in France since the autumn of 1314, a steady snow cover had been formed, a phenomenon that almost disappeared from the middle of the 9th century. Heavy rains and unusually harsh winters led to the death of several crops and the extinction of orchards. Viticulture and wine production ceased in Scotland and northern Germany. Harsh winters began to hit even northern Italy. Petrarch and Boccaccio wrote that it was not uncommon for snow to fall in Italy at that time. The glaciers began to encroach on Greenland, the summer thawing of the ground became increasingly short-lived, and by the end of the century, permafrost was firmly established there. The amount of ice in the northern seas increased. In Russia, the Little Ice Age was marked, in particular, by exceptionally cold summers when frost hit in July and August and snow fell in early autumn. Unusual cold weather caused bad harvests and famine, which may have been a prerequisite for the time of troubles. Before the beginning of the 19th century, the average annual temperature in Europe dropped sharply. The true causes of the Little Ice Age are difficult to name, but some researchers speak of such as increased activity of volcanoes, whose ashes overshadowed the sunlight, decrease in solar activity, the Maunder minimum, a slowdown or even a complete halt in the thermohaline circulation of the oceans. However, It seems that now we have passed another climatic optimum because the current severe frosts are too short-lived. It is most likely that our planet has entered a period of global warming, and how dangerous this period is, we will find out very soon. 4. Problems of the future and constraints. Not all current weather phenomena can be directly associated with global warming. With climate change, heat exchange processes are intensifying, the ground is heating more, the air is rising more actively, and powerful cumulus clouds are developing. Therefore, more and more often, there are unexpected downpours of such power that urban storm drain systems can't cope with them. Well, global warming is only one of the phenomena that get attention. Meanwhile, it is also changing precipitation patterns, air circulation patterns in the atmosphere, and water circulation in the oceans. The number of natural and weather disasters in the world has tripled in recent decades. Dangerous hydrometeorological phenomena like drought or heavy precipitation, which makes it impossible to harvest, have become more frequent, and agrarians are suffering enormous losses. We should also not forget that the permafrost area contains oil and gas production infrastructures that were not built with the current climate changes in mind. If nothing is done, both the number of man-made accidents and the damage caused by them will grow. As opposed to the primitive hypothesis of the dependence of the climate on only one cause, the concentration of greenhouse gases, Professor Sorokhtin and the P.P. Shurshev Institute of Oceanology of the Russian Academy of Sciences developed a physical theory of the Earth's climate. It shows that the temperature of the troposphere, the lower layer of the Earth's atmosphere, and the Earth's surface itself depend on at least 7 main factors: the distance between the Earth and the Sun and the activity of the Sun, the atmospheric pressure, the reflectivity of the Earth, its albedo, the angle of the precession of the axis of rotation of the Earth, the heat capacity of the air, the humidity, the absorption by greenhouse gases of thermal radiation from the Sun and Earth. Many processes on Earth are restraining climate change, but the safety mechanisms are failing. Snow and ice cover plays a major role in cooling the Earth by reflecting the Sun's energy back into space. The more snow available, the better the reflectivity, the lower the temperature. As it melts, less ice is left to reflect the heat. As more and more ice melts, more heat flows to the Earth, which melts more and more ice. It turns out to be a closed loop. If nothing is done about it, then further emissions of greenhouse gases will intensify the warming effect and its consequences, namely, increase of the ocean temperature, increase in the world's ocean level, increase of the average global temperature, decrease of ice in the Arctic, decrease in the volume of glaciers. All of these changes will affect completely different areas. In particular, climate change could lead to water and food shortages, migration and overpopulation, the increase of poverty, floods in coastal zones. 1 in 8 bird species, 1 in 4 mammal species, 1 in 4 conifer species, 1 in 3 amphibian species, 6 in 7 sea turtle species, and 1 in 3 reef-building coral species are under the threat of extinction. On September 16, 1987, in Montreal, Canada, 46 countries signed the Montreal Protocol. Implementation of the Montreal Protocol has reduced emissions of ozone-depleting substances fourfold since 1988. Without the Montreal Protocol, by 2050, emissions might have increased tenfold from 1980 levels, which would lead to an additional depletion of the ozone layer by a factor of 2. That is why the Paris Agreement, adopted in 2015 and intended to reduce the rate of global warming, was a logical continuation of the earlier protocols and another historic decisions along the way. 5. Ways to solve the problem. Humanity needs to increase the rate at which it cleans the atmosphere of greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide, water vapor, and methane. This requires: plant the forests and take care of them, prevent their deforestation and barbaric destruction, reduce greenhouse gas emissions into the atmosphere, switch to electric vehicles, focus on solar, wind, and other renewable energy sources, install mirrors in certain places, artificially pollute the stratosphere, similar to volcanoes, which would obscure the influx of solar radiation and lower the temperature. The author of the global warming theory, Soviet scientist, academician Mikhail Budiko, started talking about the problem back in the 1970s. he had the idea of spreading fine particles to protect against solar radiation. If we achieve a certain concentration of particles in the tropopause layer, then by reducing the solar flux by about 1%, we can reduce the temperature by 10 degrees Celsius. Academician of the Russian Academy of Sciences, Yuri Israel, one of the world's leading climate change experts, instead of reducing carbon dioxide emissions, also offered to dispel sulfate aerosols, chemtrails in the stratosphere. In 2008, a group of scientists under the leadership of Yuri Israel experimented in the small area of about 30 square kilometers. After spraying in the particle atmosphere, the devices located on the ground recorded the decrease in solar radiation. To date, the only possible answer is daunting in its simplicity. We must adapt. Adaptation to an abnormal climate must affect everyone, from personal households to the global economy. Humanity should not be fighting the specter of global warming or a new ice age, but regional environmental catastrophes caused by its activities that destroy the environment, which has led to the death of countries throughout human history, cultures, and civilizations. For the world to get back on track to meet the 1.5 degrees Celsius temperature limit target, global greenhouse gas emissions must be reduced by 7.6% annually over the next decade. The technology and strategic knowledge to reduce emissions already exist, but the transformation must begin now.